Good afternoon, Nerd Fam, and welcome back to beautiful Barcelona, Spain. We're here midway through day two of our 4 days of live coverage on theCUBE. My name's Savannah Peterson. Really excited to be doing my first segment of the show with Bob Laliberte. Bob, how's it going for you? You've been a busy man. You haven't been hanging out with me on the news desk.
I know, it's been busy, busy. Lot of vendors to see, lot of people to talk to. So, great event so far. I can't believe it's only 2 days. Feels like it's been a week.
I know, I feel like we've learned enough to have already been in a week. You're still smiling, so it's good. At least it'll be nice to you in those meetings. Very excited to welcome our next guest to the show. Nico, thank you so much for coming to hang out with us today.
Thanks for having me.
So, in my deceptively many years in the technology world, I've seen a lot of things as a service. And when we were doing our homework on you, we have Telecom as a service now. So what is Telecom as a service?
The next frontier. So, yes, everyone calls something as a service. Go with the wind, but you know, sort of like how AWS converted compute and storage to a service, fintech, Stripe into a service. So we're doing essentially the same thing, but for telecom, and we are taking like a pretty sort of vertically integrated approach to it, where we're the network, and then we offer that as a service. Whereas you know, sometimes in telecom, like people would say, I can sell you my plan. I resell the plan. Now here we're saying like, you know, similar to how Shopify solved all the issues around e-commerce.
Yeah.
Sort of the analogy for what we're trying to do with telecom.
Yeah, and this is not, I mean, creating telecom environments is not simple. It's not something you just spin up a telecom network the next day. But from our conversations we've had previous, you're able to get a basically, you know, maybe an MVNO spun up much faster than ever before. And right. I'm wondering if you could share, like the time frames I remember was like 12 to 18 months down to 8 weeks or something like that?
Even faster.
Even
honestly,
faster.
Like, it depends on the use case, but we could have a meeting and set it up during the meeting and walk away with an MVNO instantiated. Of course, you need to work on the brand and the marketing and the distribution, but like the technology itself, you could, in an hour, set it up, basically.
Yeah, which is crazy, because
wow.
When you're talking for, yeah.
An hour?
Yeah, and
that's
so.
That's awesome.
And so for what people are saying, right, MVNO, mobile virtual network operator, easy for me to say. exactly, right?
That was like a pun in itself,
I know. So setting up an MVNO in just a couple of hours when it used to take so long to do that really changes the game, right? And
absolutely,
that's what was so
yeah.
impressive when looking at the technology. But that's not where you start and finish, right? It's not just about enabling MVNOs. It's a little, right? It's a little more than that.
No, absolutely. I mean, the approach is like, you know, telco has been always like very insular. You know, if you think about it, it's one of those industries where in each country, different players having their own black boxes.
That's sovereignty, the governance there is insane too.
And then meanwhile, the world is going global, and everything is connected, right? So you have more and more demand for connecting anything, you know, from people to machines to everything in between. And the issue is the networks and the industry is just not set up for that, right? Like the basic construct, we're just talking about it like 25 years ago is, I buy a whole bunch of equipment, put it together, I build my network, I sell you access to my network, right?
Right.
Now the construct is the network belongs to someone, but the experience is somewhere else, right? So how do you transfer the experience? Mm-hmm. And then the issue after that is technology, right? So like we just announced our launch in partnership with AT&T in the US. Their network is to service 120 million people in the US, right? First and foremost, right? So they don't like others to start coming into the network as, you know, touching their stuff, like, you know, reliability and issues like this. You got to get a license, you got to get SIMs. So it ended up like, every time you want to innovate in connectivity, it's an 18 months process, it's a lot of capital, it's a lot of convincing operator, it's a lot of this, you know, having to compromise on a number of things, right? And we looked at that, and similar to, you know, Shopify or AWS, there's a whole series of problems that are already solved, right? So solve that, take care of like legal, technology, regulatory, all of this, and let the company just take that as a service and then build upon it, right? And you see a lot of companies, I'll give you an example, Cubic Telecom, just SoftBank acquired them like a year ago. Their business is high value asset tracking. Mm. Right? But when they started, you could not connect stuff around the world, so they first had to build a network and then operate a global network, and then you build your value add on top of it, right? So for me, like it's kind of like the analogy with Uber, where it's like, if I want to build Uber, I need to build the roads first, and then I will build the logistics portion, right? And so we're saying that, you know what, actually, we know how to build roads, so we'll build the road, maintain it for you, give you nice tools and APIs, and then focus on the use case on top of that, right? And that's how you kind of shave off the timeline.
Well, it's these types of collaborations that are going to move the industry forward and give us that agility and scalability that we've been needing. I got to ask you, just because I'm an AT&T customer, does this mean that I'm about to have a better experience?
Nah, well, unless you move to one of our customers, but no, I mean, basically, like, you know, the thing in telco is like layers and layers and layers, right? It's sometimes even like astonishing that those things actually work if you know exactly how that works. Like, it's just, but it's also like legacy tech, and you know, us starting
lots
5 years ago,
tech.
You know, you want to go to the cloud first, you want to go AI first. A company like AT&T or anyone else of their peers, right, it's legacy tech that's been built over the years. So basically the way it works is that we use their towers, and then in some countries we use multiple providers, but like right now we just announced AT&T in the US. And so if you have an AT&T SIM, you get to the tower, you go to their network. If you have one of the OXIO customer SIMs, you go to a SIM tower, but you go to a different network, basically, right? And so everything that tends to be requiring a lot of customization, personalization, things that need to, AI at the core, scale of a, global scale, that comes to us, and that's how we kind of work together.
One of the things that caught my eye was the fact that it's not just enabling network operators, but you're able to, because you've simplified, you've taken all of the hassle out of building this, you're getting like retail organizations and others who are saying, yeah, we want to have this and be able to deliver it as well. I wonder if you could talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, and that's the thing, like, you come to a show like this and, people will tend to think about MVNOs because, Mint Mobile, like Ryan Reynolds, like just the whole thing. But the reality is most of the use cases are in the enterprise space on things that you would not necessarily think about, right? And one that we're going to be launching soon is an enterprise MVNO for bankers, effectively.
Okay.
The whole idea is like, they're in the financial industry, they're regulated, communication needs to be recorded for compliance. To me, it's a good example of the things that we solve that carriers cannot solve. Because today, let's say you're at Morgan Stanley, you get a SIM from AT&T, but that SIM is not recorded, right? So then you got to go download special apps and say, don't use WhatsApp, don't use the phone, don't use SMS, don't do anything, right? Go use this other app. If you use anything else, you're out of compliance. And then obviously, right, just everyone is on a different app, so some employees slip, and right now it's $3 billion in fine just in the US, right, for the banks. Right. Versus, and the issue is that the guys that are doing the compliance, they cannot go around the world and start like doing the integration 200 times, it costs millions of dollars every time, it's going to be different integration. So it's just as a function of how the industry is structured, you end up having this like really subpar solution for arguably the guy sitting on the money, right? So in our case, they came to us and then we're a global wholesale carrier effectively, so they do integration once, forward, voice, SMS, and data, and then from there they're able to go and make sure there's 100% compliance on the recording. And that SIM is universal, like you can make it everywhere. So the only thing that changed at that point is the license in the country and the tower in the country. Everything else is exactly the same, right? It's something like this, not really sexy, but those are the big problems that
Correct.
The industry itself has not been able to resolve, right?
Well, it's not sexy until you realize how much money and capital is wasted, how much innovation can't happen, and how much that depreciates the quality of the community's experience.
Absolutely, yeah.
So I think all of those things are sexy. I'm going to counter you on that, Nico.
Generating money is sexy.
Yeah.
No, but there's a lot of things, right? I'll give you another one where, with eSIM now, it's so easy to download. They're very cheap. So there's a lot of fraud with communication, right? And so you have guys that build incredibly sophisticated system around, how you hold your phone, how you speak today, how you, intonation, and all of this, right? To figure out if it's the real person or not the real person. What you can do now is you can delegate that to an eSIM. So the use case is, you bank with, Bank America, download an eSIM, and every time you communicate with a banker, it's a dedicated closed-loop network. So now they know it's you as a customer, you know you're talking to the bank, there's no phishing, right? So it's tiny little things like this where you actually save a lot of money on the other side, because like fraud is rampant and massive, right? And so for me, like, this is the kind of stuff I like in telecom, because you really solve actual issues at that point, right? It's like very deterministic, it's like very concrete use case. And then everything in between, right? Like, the MVNO around like celebrities and brands and everything.
Yeah, and a lot of this value that you're bringing to the market is due to the fact that you're on this modern cloud native hosted in the cloud platform that you've built, right?
Right.
I mean, I remember, what is it, 10 years or so ago, coming here and everyone was just at the stage where they were trying to get off appliances and go software based.
Right.
Right. And now in that such a short period, we've gone from that to be the shift to the cloud.
I mean, it would be hard for us, you know, because a startup, it's already hard to compete in the talent space, right? Because it's, you know, billions of dollars, giant companies. So you need to find your secret sauce somewhere that will create like a differential advantage, right? Because you're not going to compete with Verizon or, you know, Ericsson, right? But this is where the cloud and AI give us the weapons to do those things. For us, you know, it's a couple of things. Like the network is global, so we're the first, and we're not fully global yet, but that's the first time a network is on a global level, right? Because even if you take like a Vodafone or a Telefonica, if they're in 15 countries, they have 15 networks, right? Like the network in Italy is different from the network in Spain, is different from the network in France. In our case, the idea is like it's a single entity, so you have to change all the rules around licensing and everything. So moving everything to the cloud, where we are today, if we want to open a new country, we basically seek a license in the new country, we get a wholesale agreement, and then we're primarily on Amazon today. Amazon will extend the infrastructure into Amazon, and then everything gets spun up, right, basically overnight. If we had to do old school deployment in data center, it's not a job for a startup, right? Like, it's just not.
So in that case, when you're talking about setting up that global environment, if someone has one of the OXIO SIMs, they can travel between country to country without having to pre-set up an international plan, do anything like
that. You're not even roaming at that point.
Right, not even roaming. So it's not like they don't think they're on someone else's network, they're just on the OXIO network or however it's branded network.
I'll give you an example. We're about to launch a customer in the US who is focused on the Hispanic market, right? And as we know, right, a lot of Hispanics in the US with family back home or friends or whatever. And so the idea is they're building basically a super app on top of our rails where it's combining telecom, fintech, and content. They have like a streaming platform on top of it. But what's cool is because we're a global carrier, we're creating family plans but with number from different countries. So now the guys in Texas, they have the US number, the cousin in Mexico has a Mexican number, and the friend in Colombia has a Colombian number, but everyone's on the same plan, right? So. And then, you know, there's no roaming, so you go to Mexico to US or vice versa.
That's really beautiful. I've done, first of all, it's just great from a family perspective in general. And it's, I think it, that might sound like a small thing to someone who doesn't have a family plan, let's put it that way. But it's actually quite a big thing when you're thinking about balancing your family's communications. I used to do, well, I still do, a lot of work between here and New Zealand, and I know this dance so well, and it's always driven me quite mad that there wasn't a better solution for this. It's always felt like, and I say this with a lot of love, it's always felt a little bit like telco lagged behind in a lot of aspects, largely because of these political boundaries and you know, literally geography in a lot of different cases. But I mean, I remember when leaving my county was roaming and cost a bajillion dollars when I was younger. We're at this really interesting moment where I feel like everything's starting to move together and accelerate in a way that is mutually beneficial for innovation. Since you're making these big announcements, you've got all these partnerships. Nico, if you could wave a magic wand right now and have the industry understand something, what would you want them to understand?
I mean, I'm not the only one, but I think telecom, going back to your point, is about experiences now. It's about digital experiences, and it's tailored to how you work, the lifestyle, with who you interact. You know, your usage is very real, but like, I'll give you another one. Ton of students coming to the States to study.
Yeah.
Most of the time, you got to keep a line back home because the bank needs to send you code, or, you know, things of that nature. Why can't I have just one phone number that I can use for the stuff from back home, right? Or you go to New Zealand and that's the same number, now it's just a different country, right? So telco becomes, this is where it's interesting, like telco become like a widget almost in someone ecosystem, right?
It's that's a good analogy.
And then, you know, when Revolut launched the eSIM last year, which, you know, everyone was talking about it, right? It's like, Revolut is not a telco player, right? Revolut is known for being a fintech, but it's like, hey, I can help my customer with a pain point, and, you know, why not, right? And Nubank has done the same thing and others, right? So we see this convergence between like telco and other services, but where telco becomes just a base widget, really.
Yeah.
And then the second thing is where we are today. Like, the reason why we operate the network ourselves is one, to have the opportunity to pilot it through AI, right? So like the typical telco might have 10,000 engineers, we have an AI, right? It's also the value of the data. The data in the telco silos exists. Everyone talk about it. We're talking about.
Oh yeah. Silos are quite the conversation, especially in this industry.
I mean, 15 years ago, it was like big data, right?
Yeah.
But no one's really doing anything, right? But the thing is, like, if you're bringing telco in someone else's ecosystem, now how does telco help someone like Revolut versus how someone helps like Walmart, or how does it help all those things, right? So it's a data world, right? So the network needs to be re-architected to collect the data. We're in a privacy first, right? So we got to secure that data. Telco, it's 24/7, so it's a ton of data. So now you use AI to process the data and then just drop the one inside that makes sense at that point, right? So if you're fintech, it might be financial qualification. If you're retail, it might be about how do I compete better with my customer. In the case of that experience for Latinos, right, it's primarily content-based, right? So how do I monetize this audience better by knowing who they are, right? Because in the US, like, people tend to put Hispanics in one box, right? They're like, oh, very different, right? Vote differently, buying powers are different, viewing. And so for them, it's mega important. And then you can find those personas from the telco usage, right? So this is where, like, you create this kind of flywheel where telco is almost the source of information. It's the experience. But to your point, it's not an industry. And this industry, like, it's not like a dedicated business that it used to be before, right? It's,
This integration is really cool. You're making my mind go a lot of different directions, which is really fun. This has been amazing, and we are a little over time, but you're fascinating, Nico, so I really appreciate it. One final question for you. When we have the good fortune of having you back on the show next Mobile World Congress in 2026, what do you hope to be able to say then that you can't say now?
A lot of customer launching with really cool use cases that we cannot really talk about. And I get excited because I get to say that all those things are so different, it's the same platform behind it. So that'll be exciting.
Okay, well, we look forward to meeting the customers. You get to show off with us.
Forward to showing you the next section.
Absolutely.
Sounds great, Nico. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Thank you so much.
Thanks. And thank you, Bob. This has been blessed.
Absolutely.
Always a pleasure. And thank all of you for tuning in wherever you might be on our beautiful planet. We're here in Barcelona, Spain. Day two of our 4 days of coverage. My name's Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.